Hello and good evening. This is the Jeff Vaughn Show. It is Friday, October 4th, 2024, and we just have 30 days until the election. We're going to talk about the news this week, what went right, what went wrong. We'll talk about the debate that happened on Tuesday, the vice presidential candidates squaring off. I'll talk about the ups and downs, the hits and misses of that. Also, the day after the election, and as I mentioned, it's just 30 days, there will be talk about the 2028 race. And so I want to talk and spend some time on the bench for the Democratic side and the bench on the GOP side after this election in just a month. Can you believe that? We are in the home stretch. Also, that debate that happened on Tuesday was a pretty good one. I was excited about that. We got some policy, and we'll talk about that. But also, that was on CBS News. Let's talk about the moderator's performance. We'll hit that. I know at this point in time it's kind of old news, but I do want to bring it up, and I want to spend just a little bit of time on it. It's not going to be a deep dive. It's a Friday. It's been a long week. I'm not even going to mention anything about Hurricane Helene and the aftermath and what's going on there. And I'm going to wrap up this podcast here with Pete Rose. He passed away this week, and I want to spend some time talking about him. So first, let's get to that debate. Here's what I was looking for. So first of all, I was very excited for this debate, and I think a number of people tuned in to the vice presidential debate for the first time, at least a number of people that I talked to, and some of the polls showed that America had a renewed interest in the VP debate for a couple of reasons. One is, this is probably the last political event that we're going to get between now and the election. No more debates scheduled. And this is really kind of the first time that we've seen J.D. Vance and Tim Walz. And this was the only time that they're going to debate. I think they're relatively unknown, both of them. And so I think a lot of people wanted to tune in to see how they were going to do. I did not get the numbers of the millions of people that tuned in. I did see a poll that said 75% of the people are going to tune in. I thought that was way too high. That'd be like 200 million people. And I don't have the numbers. I don't think it was that big of a group. I think probably a lot of people tuned in, maybe dipped in and out. But by and large, there's not a whole lot of interest in the VPs. I think there was additional interest just because of the stakes here in this one. So let's talk about that. Here's what I was looking for. First of all, let's talk about the Democratic side and Minnesota Governor Tim Walz. So this is what I thought going into the debate on Tuesday night. In my opinion, Tim Walz could not win the debate. He actually couldn't really have a good performance in the debate. Quite frankly, I think he probably needed to have a mediocre to bad performance. And the reason is because everything that I hear about Kamala Harris is that she does not want to ever be outshined. And if you outshine her, then you're in trouble. I mean, if he was to knock it out of the ballpark, seeing how we're going to talk about Pete Rose, if he was to knock it out of the ballpark and hit a grand slam, I don't know if he would be the vice presidential candidate the next day. Because if you take a look at the history of Kamala Harris, just in the turnover on her offices alone, the staff, a lot of it is because maybe there are people that kind of, I don't want to say smarter than her, but maybe a little bit better at her. We've all heard about how she's not very good at planning, and I've understood that some of the people that worked for her kind of criticized her for that, and as a result, they're gone. So I had a concern that if Walz did really, really well, that he probably wouldn't be the candidate, that he probably would, I don't want to say he'd be, made to leave, maybe. But anyway, I don't think that that's going to be the issue, because I don't think he won the debate, and I don't think that he had the opportunity to outshine Kamala Harris. He did do a good job. He was a solid, solid job. And that's what was so great about this debate, in my opinion, as a guy who really likes to hear about policy and to really see what the candidates are about, because it has been a long time since we've had a candidate that will actually talk about policy. And we did get some in this debate. And this has been a very policy-light campaign, presidential campaign. So I was kind of happy. I was looking forward to that, and I got it. Between J.D. Vance and Tim Walz, I definitely got a little bit more policy, and I understood them a little bit more. But I got to tell you, I don't think the campaign of Kamala Harris is very happy about the mounting missteps that Walz is going through. I mean, just since being tapped as Harris's running mate, he's had to explain a growing number of inaccurate statements and at times embellishments. You saw some of that there in the debate. They range from comments about his military service to his visit to Hong Kong. That was brought up there in the debate. That was a really bad answer on his part. Very cringy. I was myself going, ooh, that was not good. He called himself a knucklehead. He says, I speak like everybody else. I don't know. To me, it's the things are mounting against him. And I just wonder if Kamala Harris and the campaign is going to use him as the excuse if they lose. So really, in my opinion, Walz could not do a good job. I think he probably knew that. And you could see it. I mean, he was cast aside. He was nervous early on. And in fact, just a few days leading up to the debate, he had publicly said that he told Kamala Harris when she picked him that he's not a good debater and that he was nervous in those sessions leading up to it. So I think they were trying to not only lower expectations, but I think he's probably told, don't you hit out of the ballpark there. Nobody is going to outshine Kamala. So anyway, let's spend some time on that related to Tim Walz. I think he finished strong. I think his closing statement was pretty good. And he obviously did take J.D. Vance to task related to January 6th and won some points there. So let's talk about J.D. Vance. So here's what I was looking for when it came to J.D. Vance. I actually did not like the pick of him as vice president. I thought with his lack of experience, only 2 years as a senator, he's not even finishing out his term if he is elected to the or to become the vice president. I mean, it's hard for him to say he's ready and also to criticize Kamala Harris and her lack of experience because he actually has less experience. I thought Donald Trump should have picked Marco Rubio. That's who I wanted. And so J.D. Vance wasn't out of left field. He obviously was on the radar. There were enough trial balloons sent up about him that I was able to do a little bit of research on him, but he still was not somebody that impressed me. And it goes back to his experience. He's an impressive guy. He obviously was a Marine in the military. He wrote Hillbilly Elegy. Very smart guy. So it's not that I didn't trust that he would do a good job. I just didn't think he had enough experience. And to me, that's kind of like you can't get up there and complain about somebody when you have less experience than them. Maybe that's old school about me. I mean, it's all new now. He's only in his 40s. So, and I think it's nice to have a little bit of energy. But what he did during that debate, I was kind of looking for Vance to see in talking about in 4 more years, that bench, if he could take the top of the ticket. Because day one, if Trump is elected, he's going to be a lame duck. On January 20th, when he is inaugurated, if he wins, he is immediately a lame duck. He can only serve 4 more years. And I was looking at this debate to see, can Vance take the top of the ticket? Because he's then the vice president. So in 4 years, it would make sense that he would run for president. And I didn't really think that he would be able to do that. But that debate changed my mind. I was looking to see if he could take the top of the ticket in 2028. And he did convince me that he deserves to run definitely as president in 2028. Now, I think obviously we need a primary. I mean, we're not Democrats here. I think they need to make sure that J.D. Vance and whoever, whether it be Marco Rubio or Vivek Ramaswamy or Nikki Haley or Tulsi Gabbard or whoever decides to run, obviously he needs to go through the Democratic process and they need a primary. Glenn Youngkin is somebody else. Byron Donalds is somebody. Tim Scott, obviously, he will have a lot of competition. But I thought in that debate, it proved to me that he could take the top of the ticket, and I felt comfortable with that. If he was to run after 4 years of Trump and to run for president, I would think that he would be ready. And I got to tell you, the reason why I believe he was better prepared for that Now, I'm a journalist. I have been doing interviews with politicians and people for 30 plus years, and I appreciate that they get out there and they do interviews and make themselves available. And that's what J.D. Vance has done since he was announced as VP. You probably already heard this. In the short time that he was announced during the RNC, he's done over, this was last week, 130 interviews, so now probably 150 plus. He's doing more than two interviews a day. And that's smart. I mean, and he's taking on all comers. So really, steel sharpens steel. And that is part of the vetting process. We should expect our candidates to be available to be interviewed by all comers. Because then it's a vetting process. We know more about them and they become better when it comes to their policies. And if they adjust it, then I'm fine with that. As long as it's not huge adjustments, you know, no flip-flopping. I think I would rather see somebody get out there and come up with an idea or two and then kind of hone it over time through those interviews. So Vance did 130 interviews. Walz, less than 10. And that really showed to me in that debate. So I'm really in favor of a candidate mixing it up, going through the vetting process. Every voter should want that. Every voter should have an opportunity to see. And again, I just think that JD, in my opinion, won the debate. He did a good job and can be on the top of the ticket now. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the bench, because since we're on J.D. Vance, let's talk about the GOP side. I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time. I'm not going to go through all of these people. I'm sure that you probably know it. If you're into politics, you're listening to this podcast, you probably know who I'm going to speak of here. But I will kind of spend a little bit more time on the Democrats. But when it comes to the bench for the GOP, in my opinion, it's Marco Rubio, Glenn Youngkin, Nikki Haley, Ron DeSantis. Maybe Ron DeSantis is damaged goods, though, after his primary run against Trump. I don't know. I haven't decided yet. Byron Donalds, Tim Scott, Vivek Ramaswamy. There could be some wild cards out there, too. I would not be surprised if Don Jr. or Laura Trump, who's married to Eric Trump, which is the son of former President Trump. I wouldn't be surprised if Don Jr. or Laura Trump ran on the top of the ticket for the GOP. I think the GOP is better positioned for 2028 than the Democrats are, and I say that without really knowing who may come up on the progressive side. But just to name those names, they're known quantities. Every single one of those people you kind of know about, you know of. And with J.D. Vance now kind of coming on the scene, all of these people, Marco Rubio, a great statesman. I think that he's obviously been doing it for a long time. Any one of them, in my opinion, has the credentials to run to be president. But I do think the GOP is better positioned than the Democrats are at this point in time. So let's take a look at the Democrats' bench today. So you have to, I really hesitated to put this name on here. I live in California. I'm in Los Angeles. And I think he probably was a more viable candidate a few months ago. He certainly wanted to be. You know who I'm talking about. California Governor Gavin Newsom. But when I arrived here in California in 2015, since then and now, Newsom has lost the state. When I arrived, people supported him. And they loved him. Now, that is minus the sycophants that will support him no matter what. And it's just not the case now. In fact, I was on a phone call with a friend of mine earlier today. And I have friends that vary along the political spectrum. This one happens to be to the left. And even he was complaining about Gavin Newsom. And it's interesting how the complaints that I've heard over the years about Gavin Newsom have gone from the political to the practical. It used to be maybe they didn't like him politically, but they were going to continue to vote for him. And now they're just like, I can't believe where we are. I can't believe that the state is going in this direction. It's all because of him. So a lot of people supported him. I just don't think Gavin Newsom is any longer a viable candidate to be president of the United States. First of all, he's getting outshined and outdone by Kamala Harris. He wanted that position. There was no primary. I think he wanted to be in that. And doesn't that make you think about how Gavin Newsom would have stood up against J.D. Vance? Or I'm sorry, how Gavin Newsom would have stood up against Trump in that first debate? That would have been interesting. So he did definitely miss an opportunity there. I think his time has come and gone. Even here in California, he is reversing a bunch of very progressive ideas. He's now cleaning up the streets and getting the homeless, dragging the homeless off the streets and calling it a public safety issue. Well, for years, he was happy to have them there. Illegal immigration, obviously, is a big, big problem for him that's not going to go away in four more years. So I think Gavin Newsom is probably going to be seen as somebody on the bench on the Democratic side. I just don't think that he is going to be somebody that could be elected as president on the Democratic side. I put this name down because I think he's obviously going to be a candidate. Governor Josh Shapiro, I heard obviously that he was one of the VP candidates for Kamala Harris, a Pennsylvania governor. And I really don't have a whole lot to say about him because I don't know him that well, but he is definitely going to be somebody that you might see on the ticket. Pete Buttigieg, in my opinion, probably has the best chance of these. I'm going to go through a few more here. That is if he doesn't mess it up. Just recently with the transportation issues with the port strike and the aftermath of Hurricane Helene, a lot of transportation issues there. Well, where was he? He was helping out Tim Walz prep for the debate. He was standing in as J.D. Vance for that prep. And I got to tell you, if you continue to do stuff like that, it's obvious that you don't care about the people and you don't care about those that need the transportation issues fixed and you're just worrying about party. I know that's where we are. I know that's where these politicians are. It's not God, country, party. It's party, party, party first. That's basically what it is. So I think actually Pete Buttigieg has one of the better chances, again, if he doesn't mess it up. I think he's going to be somebody that could run the top of the ticket for the Democrats. Tim Walz, let's talk about him. He's definitely on the bench. But if Harris loses, he's done, in my opinion. He's done. Like Tim Kaine, who was the running mate for Hillary Clinton after she lost. I mean, he went back to Virginia. He's a senator, and he's fighting for his life in Virginia versus Captain Hung Cao, who had a really good debate performance just this week as well against Tim Kaine. That's worth taking a look at. A lot of sound bites from Hung Cao, Captain Hung Cao, who is an immigrant who came here, also served in the military. I did not have a chance to listen and watch the debate completely. I went through the sound bites of it. A lot of it was his. He was pretty quick on his feet, so it would be interesting to find out. But I don't know. If Tim Walz, if he loses, I think he's done. And that goes with Kamala Harris. She's obviously running for president. She would be a viable candidate for more years, right? Well, if she loses, she's done. I mean, it's just like being on a football team. If the running back gets injured, what's the coach do? He goes, next, get me somebody out there that can run. She's was put through this process. And if she loses, they'll see it as a failure, and they will get rid of her, just like they quickly dispatched Joe Biden. So if Kamala Harris loses, I don't think that she will ever be able to run again. Not to say that she won't. I guess my point is she won't be a viable leading candidate and won't do any damage for the Democrats. Like she won't win, basically. She will be done. And you know what? Don't worry about her. She'll go have a good life. And, whether she stays in public office and, you know, comes back here and tries to run for governor or something like that. I don't know. But, you know, you don't have to be sorry for her. She could get a private sector job and make a lot of money. So, or go on tour, write a book. I mean, she'll be fine. But that's just my opinion. If she loses this because of the situation that they put her in with this candidate in a box and just open it up and gave her everything and she loses, I think that they're going to spit her out. I think that's the machine that we have now. Let's talk about Illinois Governor J.D. Pritzker. A lot of people say that he is also on the short list to run in 2028. I kind of think he's like Gavin Newsom. And it's also very hard for a billionaire to attack billionaires, which is what the Democrats are all about now. So I don't think that he is one of those that has a serious chance of running for president. Maryland Governor Wes Moore, I've heard, is a rising star. I haven't done a lot of research on him, but I've had a few Democrats mention him. So that's somebody to watch. So that's basically who I think is going to be looked at in four more years. So I kind of wanted to get something going a little bit ahead because we've been talking so much about things that have happened from this week. And that's why this podcast exists. We're talking about things that have already happened, but just looking ahead. I just kind of think that that's something to think about. And going back to the night of the debate, it just was something. Actually, I was talking about this with Larry Elder. It was on Salem News Channel, and I was doing anchoring the political coverage after the debate, the post-debate. And I kind of told him a little bit about the reason why I thought Walz couldn't hit it out of the ballpark and the reason why I thought if J.D. Vance did a good job, that might propel him to the top of the ticket in four more years. So anyway, we talked about that. Let's talk about CBS and their performance. They, of course, hosted the debate. Now, in case you didn't know, we had fact checkers on ABC with David Muir and Lindsay Davis, and they were criticized for only fact checking one side. And they did. I mean, any way you look at it, this is what's wrong with politics and people that just pick one side over the other. People saw that they only fact-checked one side, and people will tell me, oh, that's because Kamala Harris didn't lie. It's like, come on. They're politicians. They lie. It's obvious if you're only fact-checking one side. Well, CBS kind of saw what happened to ABC News and the criticism that they got, rightly so. And so they came out and said that they would not be actively fact-checking the candidates. But they did. So they did. And I don't know if it was an audible that was called by the moderators, which was Margaret Brennan and Norm O'Donnell. And by the way, I didn't feel like those two had very good chemistry as moderators of the debate. So they talked about not fact-checking, and then they did fact-check. In fact, not only did they do that, they cut off the mic. And of course, they just cut it off to one side, which would be the Republican candidate in J.D. Vance. That was a big moment for me. If you're CBS, in my opinion, in order to show that you're unbiased, if he's fact-checking you right back, you got to take it. It's just, first of all, it's just a bad look. When you say you're not going to fact-check, and then you do it, but only for one candidate, and when the candidate tries to check the fact-check, then they turn off the microphone and move on and kind of dismiss them. It's just not a good look if you're a news agency. I mean, I've already had so many people tell me that all of the news outlets can't be trusted anymore. That's what they tell me. They just have no trust for it. And when they go and do that, it obviously just underscores that you can't trust them. In my opinion, and I did a little bit of research on this, and we can fault the politicians for this. They need to bring back the Commission on Presidential Debate. I mean, that was a group that started doing and hosting the debates and formulating these debates from 1988 to 2020. They actually had debates set up for 2024. What's really interesting is they're just gone now. The Commission on Presidential Debate is just history. I was on the website today. It hasn't been updated since 2020. That's the last debate. And in case you don't know, the Commission on Presidential Debates basically was put together as a 501c3, as a nonprofit, to put together presidential debates. This was four of them they had planned for 2024, two in September, two in October. And with that, they would invite moderators from different news organizations. So therefore, you don't have CBS hosting it, or ABC, or Fox, or MSNBC, or whoever. And I actually really enjoyed that, because you could see a presidential debate where you'd have three moderators from three different news organizations that would ask the questions. And I think part of the deal is that those moderators didn't necessarily, I think they would talk the topics, they would divvy up the topics, but they would not tell the other moderators what their questions were. And I think that's better. I actually have moderated a number of political debates over the years, and that's how it was always done. I was one of two or three. Like, for example, when I was in San Antonio, I moderated a debate, and I was with the CBS affiliate, the local CBS affiliate. There was somebody with a newspaper, and there was somebody in radio. And I don't know what their slant was. It was a good debate. We had a good debate. I just think the Commission on Presidential Debate, the organization, should come back. But here's the deal. They were set up in 2024 to do this. There were three presidential debates, one VP debate, two in September, two in October. But it's just another norm that has been broken. The campaigns just sidestepped them and committed to network debates. Candidates are scared now to have anybody ask them questions. And the Democrats would only do a favorable network. That's how they got CNN with the Trump-Biden debate. That's how they got ABC News, where they fact-checked just one side, being Trump. And that's how they got CBS, where, again, they said they weren't going to fact-check, but then they fact-checked just one side, the member of the GOP. And so I wouldn't be surprised if these debates just go away. I would be sad if that happened. I think you, the voter, should be outraged. But that's kind of what's happening now, right? The voter is less powerful, because they are really stemming how many times they are interacting with the public, and how they're interacting in with news organizations to disseminate that down to the public and to the voters. It's really a sad time for the voters. I never would have thought that a few years ago. And I was a political science major. I love politics. I've followed politics. I've dealt in politics and reported on politics my whole adult life. And I never, ever, until this year, ever thought I would say that presidential debates will go away. But at this point in time, I wouldn't be surprised if they did. Mark my words, if it benefits them, they're going to do it. I mean, we already have candidates in Kamala Harris and Tim Walz that are doing nary an interview. I said Tim Walz did less than 10. I don't know how many Kamala Harris has done. I've told you how many J.D. Vance has done, more than 130. I don't know about Trump. Trump in October, not of this go-around, but in 2020, leading up to November, I believe he did some 65 town halls in 1 month. I'm sorry, 65 Trump rallies in 1 month. So, I mean, he does roughly two a day. And he's out there. I mean, whether you say it's newsworthy or not, I mean, I haven't been to a Trump rally. I haven't really watched a Trump rally, but obviously he is out there, and he does get quoted, and the media goes. That is making himself available. So I wouldn't be surprised if these debates go away. And I used to think that it was because Democrats just wanted to have favorable news organizations, and they've done that, but Trump is not agreeing to do any more debates. And I got to tell you, do you blame him after what's happened? I mean, I think he should. I'm all in favor of more debates. But when you see what has gone on, you really can't. And, you know, these politicians are so thin-skinned. They're such babies. And if they don't have to do it, they won't. So, enough on that. When will we get the commission back? I don't understand why we still don't have it. I mean, like I said, there's a website there, but it would be great if we could start that. Maybe I'll start it. Maybe we can get the commission back and we can get this going and do another round of debates in four more years and make them worthwhile. Okay, it is Friday night. I want to end with Pete Rose, Charlie Hustle, the Hit King. Just a little bit of background. Obviously, I mean, I love baseball. When I was a kid, I played Little League baseball. I played from like T-ball. I snuck in and I had my grandfather was a good friend of the sponsor of the T-ball team. And so I think I was playing before I was supposed to. And I was playing in the position of pitcher at T-ball. So I got a lot of the ground balls. And I was a pretty good player. I really enjoyed it. It was my thing. And I wanted to be just like Pete Rose. And I also wanted to be like George Brett. George Brett played third base, and I played third base, and so that was easy. And growing up in Kansas, he played for the Royals, so of course that was easy too. But he had just a wonderful couple of seasons with the Royals when I was in high school. But Pete Rose was before that. So when I was in Little League, I used to run the bases and jump head first, just like Pete Rose. And I would get in trouble because you'd end up getting a bloody nose. And if you do that during a game and somebody catches the ball and they're trying to get you out at second, they're hitting you in the head with the ball inside the glove. But I did it nonetheless, and the coach was always – he would make reference to Pete Rose. Be like Pete Rose and run back and forth from the field, from the dugout to the field. Run every single ground ball out. And it was really a good person to emulate. If your coach is telling you, and you took a look at what Pete Rose did, he was Rookie of the Year. He had the most hits at 4,256 hits in Major League Baseball. He's the Hit King. The most games played, the most at-bats, most singles, two World Series wins. He was MVP of the league. MVP of the World Series, two Golden Gloves, 17 All-Star appearances. He played five positions. He never looked to me like an outfielder, but man, that guy had some deceptive speed and the angles he would take. I mean, I just loved him. And of course, he had some problems with gambling. He was banned for gambling on baseball, although I believe he admitted only to betting on football, basketball, and horse racing, not baseball, but I'm not certain. There's that whole, allegations against him and that he did bet against baseball, and because of that, he will never be in the Hall of Fame. And I think that that's too bad, because if you look at statistics, he should be in the Hall of Fame. First ballot way back in the day. And maybe things will change. I understand it's a permanent ban, not a lifetime ban. So I understand that just because he has passed away, that he will not be considered for the Baseball Hall of Fame. But I hope that he does. Because I've always been somebody who has looked at athletes based on their stats. I mean, O.J. Simpson, does he belong in the Hall of Fame? He does. In my opinion, based on stats. And if you just do that, then you really don't leave any sort of gray area. And you just put him in there, and he should be in there. I mean, it's amazing what he has done. So maybe he will someday. I don't know. But it was something that hit me when he passed away at the age of 83. And it just kind of brought me back to that time and place when I was in Little League and you know, probably second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth grade. And Pete Rose was one of my idols. I'd choke up the bat and I would dive head first and I would hustle everywhere I went because I wanted to be like him. And you know what? What's really interesting is the game of baseball for little leaguers is different now. Not that you can't be a kid and be Charlie Hustle and go out there. But so many of these kids, even the little leaguers, are specializing now in, you know, maybe one position, because he was a utility player, Pete Rose. Or they are just not hustling like they used to, which is sad. But I just think that Pete Rose is probably not going to be seen, as far as kids go, and emulating him on the diamonds anymore, because, one, he's an older player, but I just don't think that it's something that coaches can tell kids to do anymore. I mean, I have a young man, he's 12 years old, who's in water polo, and he does great, and he listens to his coach, but I see, you know, he's part of a team, and it's a little bit different from when I was a kid. So, Pete Rose, I'm sorry to see you go, and I hope you make it to the Hall of Fame someday. That's going to wrap it up for the Jeff Vaughn Show. Please check me out on all of those social media websites. I am Jeff Vaughn on Twitter, also known as X. You can check me out, Jeff Vaughn Media, on YouTube. That's where this podcast will be. Also, I'm on Instagram. Jeff Vaughn Journalist is my handle there, as well as Jeff Vaughn Journalist on Twitter and on Facebook. And by all means, leave a comment. Let me know what you want to hear and talk about. I want to thank everybody Tuesday night for tuning in to Salem News Channel as I covered the post-debate for the VPs on Tuesday. It was a lot of fun. And I'll be doing election night coverage for Salem as well. Also, the daily news drop on my socials. You'll see that every single day. And I'm also starting an After the Bell report. Business news is one of my passions. I love personal investing, business news. I love leadership in companies. I love stocks and investing and personal investing and whatnot. And so I've started that actually on the 7th, on Monday. So look for that on my socials as well. The After the Bell report, I'll give you a market update of what happened from Wall Street on that day. Thank you so much for tuning in, and have a great day.